Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for frame rate is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This episode of Frame Rate is brought to you by Netflix. Watch thousands of TV episodes and movies on your PC, Mac, iPad, iPhone, or TV instantly. All streamed directly to you, saving you time, money, and hassle. For your free 30-day trial, go to Netflix.com/twit. And by Squarespace.com, the fast and easy way to create a high-quality website or blog. For a free trial and 30% off your new account for 3 months, go to Squarespace.com and use the offer code FRAMERATE6. Frame Rate episode 29. I'm Tom Merritt.
I'm Brian Brushwood.
And it's good to be back right in the frames.
Yeah, although, you know, you're back in the saddle, right in the studio. You're on your A-game location. I'm in our East Coast studios here at the Anime Con studio, courtesy of one P. Delahante from the chat room. Big, big thanks to Patrick for letting us crash and steal his bandwidth, is 100% reliable, and I'm told will never, ever crap out.
Are you there, Brian? Are you there? I'm kidding. His bandwidth is totally 100% reliable.
I think he fell for it.
No, you're. Ah! I cursed us. So, Brian, what were you saying about the bandwidth there?
I was just telling it like it is, Merritt. It'll never, ever go out, and it'll never. It's as though his bandwidth has like a sense of humor, because we started the show. And then right as I introduced myself, it crapped out. This is after like 20 minutes of everything fine. And then I announced that everything will go totally fine and I get the treatment again.
Yes. Okay. Well, let's just move on then to the big story, shall we? Still there, Brian?
Yes, I am.
Okay, good.
This just ends
the
big story.
Now, this just broke mere hours before we started recording Frame Rate, even hours before the first three times we started recording Frame Rate. Hulu is apparently considering selling itself for money on a street corner, like a whore.
Or like an NBA player. I mean, look, those guys sell their bodies just the same. Let's not make judgments on Hulu.
Julia Boorstin from CNBC on Twitter says, "Sources tell me Hulu was approached with a buyout offer. No decisions have been made," in all caps. And then separately, Anuprita Das from the Wall Street Journal, "Hulu is weighing whether to sell itself after a potential buyer approached it with an offer. Sources, story to follow."
See, it used to be sources familiar with the matter. Now on Twitter, you just have to say sources.
Yeah, you don't have enough room for sources familiar with the matter, so you only get a couple dashes. But the Wall Street Journal article is up, but it really doesn't say anything else than those Twitter posts, to be honest, which is apparently Hulu's been approached by a potential buyer, and nobody wants to say who it is yet. Well, although in the Wall Street Journal article, Brian, it does quote people familiar with the matter.
Okay, good, because nowadays on Twitter, they just shorten it just to the word sources. They don't even give you sources familiar with the matter or anything.
Right.
And
you can find that story on peoplefamiliarwiththematter.com.
Do they really? Is it an aggregator that does
I made that site.
That's awesome. That is awesome. Here's the important thing. Hulu hasn't said anything, and all that's happened is someone said, "Hey, Hulu, nice site. You want to sell it?" And then that's it. Like, are they really considering, and for what?
How much for the website? I want your website. Sell them to me.
Who would buy it is what we were talking about on Tech News Today. And the only even slightly reasonable, although still far out there, option would be Facebook.
Oh, that's way out there.
Well, yeah. But Facebook wants to integrate music and video into their website. So that is the only one where I'm like, well, they might want to buy
Hulu.
You
know what? Actually, that could be the perfect match, because what Facebook needs is more things to do in a social way. And what Hulu needs is more community. I could totally see that
exactly. It is a stretch, like you say, but it's the only one where, like, well, okay, but I could see it working. I can't see
but
Microsoft.
But Hulu isn't even profitable at this point, is it?
No, although they were getting close to an IPO and then they backed off. So this is the right time to buy them if you are going to buy them. I just don't know who would buy them other than Facebook.
Well, and what like?
And they've said. Oh, and we should say, Wall Street Journal has reported Google is not one of the suitors. They've ruled Google out. Google has said, no, we're not interested in Hulu.
Yeah, well, and that makes sense as well. So if you're going to say, if they are going to sell, what do you think the valuation would be at? Like, I mean, not that we're experts in any stretch when it comes
really?
To this kind of thing.
I have no idea.
I mean, are we talking like you know, YouTube money or Netflix money or...
I wouldn't even know where to begin to calculate that.
I think, you know what, breaking news, we can confirm that it will be more than one U.S. dollar. This just in.
Probably be more than one Canadian.
Wait, which one is more right now?
This is an unsolicited offer, too. Don't forget.
Somebody
just walked up to the Hulu's board and said, you know, we'd like to buy it.
Yeah. Well, and I don't know. It's like, and so it could be one of those things. This sounds like such a joke. I just don't see this.
But do you think it would be good? Because, for instance, Comcast won't have the ability to approve this because they don't have board members anymore. That was a condition of them being able to acquire NBC was that NBC would give up their board members on Hulu, but they still own an interest in it. And I could see Comcast running behind the scenes saying, yeah, sell. We don't want these restrictions that are on us from Hulu anymore.
Well, what about could it be one of the big broadband suppliers buying it with the intention of, you know, one of these cable companies either trying to diversify
their
position?
What if Comcast was going to buy it? But they'd still have the restrictions. They couldn't have NBC on the board. It wouldn't make any sense. Just because of the restrictions the FCC put.
Not even if they wanted to buy it to screw it up?
Maybe a Time Warner or somebody like that.
Well, I mean, because at this point, I mean, as we'll discuss more later, people really are who are cutting the cord. We're starting to see for the first time people turning off their television in their living room to watch video on TV or on their computer. Could it be the kind of thing where it's like, well, let's buy it and then we can, you know, mismanage it a bit and make it go away?
Yeah, actually, that we might as well just go to another big story because that's really where this is leading.
Yeah.
Stop everything. It's another big story.
All right. So this broke in the middle of last week, just after frame rate last week. A new research from Nielsen shows that the more web video you watch, the less time you spend on traditional TV. They have a chart showing web video streaming consumption versus TV consumption that maps out quite neatly. So it's not saying that, you know, you're definitely cutting the cord, but as you do start to watch web video, it does eat into your TV time. And a new report from the Diffusion Group surveyed Netflix users. Now, let's remember, we're just looking at people who are already watching Netflix online as it is. But of Netflix users, 32% plan on cutting at least part of their cable bill. Now, there's lots of other numbers in here about this, but what everyone seemed to be taking away with it is it's not about cord cutting. It's what they're calling cord shaving, these terms get really cute. But it's the idea of it may not kill cable, but it may stop people from buying more expensive packages.
Now, I'll tell you this much. That whole business of asking people whether or not they plan to cut their cable services, I'm going to call total shenanigans on, because I've been planning to cut the cord for 4 years now. And the fact is, it's just way, way difficult in most situations to even get close to making that happen. So I will take that story as a vote of confidence that we all intend to cut the cord, but practically it's still way, way difficult for
people
to do.
But do you think it's more likely that people say I'm planning on cutting back my service, or people saying I'm planning on cutting my service will then cut back their service, even if they don't cut it all the way?
I think there's a tremendously large gap between what people say they intend to maybe do and what actually ends up happening. And you're talking to a guy who, when I moved, I thought, this is it, I'm going to go without cable. I was like, fine, I'll get the bare minimum so my kids can have Nickelodeon. And now here I am a year later, and guess who now has the premium everything package just because I wanted to sign up for HBO for Game of Thrones. So it's like, I don't even watch half of these channels, but it's like, hey, you're subscribing for HBO. We throw in Showtime and a million other things free. And I'm
But that's you, and you're not necessarily a representative sample, right? I mean,
I certainly represent people who want more than anything to cut the cord. And I have been the guy in every survey who has announced, I plan to cut the cord. I plan to reduce services.
So it's scientifically accurate to predict what will happen in cord cutting based on you and you alone.
No. I will say that it's, My lifetime experience has shown that many people will say they want to do something and then find out that practically it's very difficult.
I agree with that principle, especially with cord cutting, which is more difficult. But I think the idea of what they're calling cord shaving, I think there is probably more likely effect there. I think people will look at that and say, you know what? I don't have to have all of these sports channels. I don't have to have all these movie channels. I'm going to, you know, especially movie channels, right? I'm going to go without those. Because I'm just going to use Netflix for that. I think that has more of a chance of people being accurate on predicting their own behavior.
Now, do you think that this kind of research would cause cable companies to shape their packages in a particular way in order to discourage cord shaving?
For example, if they see it start to happen, absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, make the gap to where it's like you're at that $97 a month range, and you're like, well, I want the lowest thing. You're like, well, the lowest thing is 14 channels, and that's $20. And you're like, well, I don't want that low. I want to be able to tune into CNN at least, and then make it to where they're like, okay, fine, and then they end up still spending roughly the same, or maybe they'll have some package where it's like a token shaving, where it's just like, well, you could save 10 whole dollars if you eliminate half your channels.
If they were smart, what they would do is they would look at those TV shows that do well on the internet, Mad Men, all of the Stars TV shows, HBO TV shows, all that stuff that's popular with the Hulu audience, and put that in a tier.
Oh,
and
man.
And say, you know what? You want to watch The Walking Dead? You got to get this premium tier. Because
I'll tell you what else
is a way to get people to spend their money.
I tell you what else they could also win by winning over some of the functionality of what people love about the Hulu and Netflix experience. Because among other things, like, I don't really care whether it's the bandwidth of IP distribution or the bandwidth of cable distribution. I just love the ease of selection to get the content that I care about. And I got to tell you, I might even keep my premier too expensive package on Time Warner if they all of a sudden came out with like the premier DVR where it had this TiVo-like beautiful interface, this concierge kind of an experience.
Oh, you mean something like Google TV with Sage TV built in?
Exactly, that kind of thing. And if it was them offering it, I think it's worth it for them to invest to try to, if you can't battle Hulu on availability and on demand, at least battle Hulu on ease of use and quality of user experience, because I think that's the biggest gap when it comes to living room TV watching experiences. I don't ever want to know channels anymore. That's like me sitting down and deciding to punch in an IP address to go to yahoo.com instead of just typing it in.
And remember, we're trying to chart the path through a blank space on the map, but we know where the end is. And the end is everything comes over the internet, and we get to choose which stuff we watch. It's going to happen. All we're figuring out is, what is the meandering path that the industry forces us to take to get to that end point? And what these studies are both saying is people are not likely to necessarily ditch their cable, but they're likely to change how they spend their money on it. And I think that's true. And the more web video people watch, the less they watch TV. The less they watch TV, the less likely they're going to want to keep certain tiers of stuff, even if they like what's on it. And there are a lot of people right into Frame Rate, right into other shows that I do, and say, you know what? Yeah, I used to watch American Idol, and I used to watch Game of Thrones and all these HBO shows, and I just said, why? I forget it. I'll watch them later. I don't have to watch them right now. And there's people like you and me who get really excited, and we're like, no, we have to watch it right now. But there's plenty of people out there that are willing to wait if they don't have to pay the extra money, and so they just get a Netflix subscription, maybe buy a few things on iTunes, cobble it together that way, and they're fine with it. They're just like, you know what? Forget it. I'll just do without some television, because honestly, it's not that hard to do. Once you've made the jump, people say, I realize I was watching too much anyway.
Well, I'll tell you what else. Now, when it comes to the real-time viewing of television shows, when it comes to certainly newsworthy things, for example, an American Idol thing, especially when you get near the end, if you don't want to have the surprise ruined when you turn on the news in the morning or open up Google News or whatever, I remember back when I cared about the first season of The Apprentice, I remember having it DVR'd because I was on the road and turned on CNN and like, and as we all know, this jackass won the game. And there seems to be also with fiction, like this sort of cutoff point where it's like, everybody's good about dancing around spoilers until you get to the end of a season or the end of a series. The second that happens, it seems like everybody's allowed to talk about what happened during the last episode. So it's like, there are shows, for example, Lost was one I got way behind in, but as we got close to the finale, I made sure to get all the way caught up because I didn't want that case of everybody talking about the end and me not knowing what the heck they were talking about.
I guess that's true, but then I'm talking about people who'd say, you know, I just don't care about those shows anymore.
I mean, are there that many people who just don't have a single show that they care about on television?
Well, or they just want to consume stuff in their own manner, in their own way, and since they don't watch television, they don't see the new shows that spoil it, I guess.
Now, which one are we, like, in our hearts? Because we're you know, want to do it when we feel like doing it, people, but we're also people who get so caught up in the story that we want to follow it at the moment.
I have been both. I have lived long years without cable, where I just didn't bother watching television.
Wait,
I was doing other things.
When did you go without cable?
From 1988 until 1997, I didn't
Holy
have cable.
Cow.
Yeah, this is before cord cutting, you know, and watching things. I just did other stuff with my time. I just didn't watch television.
Yeah, I'll tell you, through most of college,
I watched some broadcast television, but I didn't watch any cable.
Well, that was the big thing. I remember I used to get bootlegs of South Park. A friend of mine would record it because he had Comedy Central and I didn't. And he would hand me a tape every so often that I'd watch. So it's like, I've been there. I don't want to go back necessarily, especially now that I have kids. But yeah, it's certainly doable. But I don't think that's what we're entering right now. I don't know, maybe among the youngsters, the college students.
And among people who just aren't as into stuff. You know, and they're like, you know what, I want to watch a movie now and again. I don't care about getting caught up with TV shows. Don't think that's a lot of people in the audience, but I think those people exist.
All right.
Let's move on to yet another big story, if needed.
Tuck in your bootstraps. It's yet another big story.
Isn't it pull up your bootstraps? Have we talked about this before?
You know what? I believe it's slap a nun with a bootstrap.
Right.
It's time for another big story.
And that big story is an MMO that is also a television show.
Yeah, this is a neat idea. I thought this was really cool. I heard some scuttlebutt about it on E3, and there was this is the Discovery thing, right?
Yeah, well, the game is called Defiance. It's been in the works since 2008. And the idea, very simply put, is it's a story set in future post-apocalyptic version of Earth. The game you play is centered in the remains of San Francisco, while the television show takes place in St. Louis. And since it's an MMO, they both happen in real time. And so you can have character crossover where characters that you know from the MMO leave San Francisco and show up in the show in St. Louis and vice versa. People from the show can come to the MMO. Events that happen in the MMO may affect the storyline in St. Louis and vice versa. But it's a really interesting way of saying we're going to have a game and a television show, but they're not duplicating each other. They're just inhabiting the same universe.
Yeah, I wish I could remember the other example that I'd heard of that was similar to this. But I, from what I understood, is they at E3, the folks who were presenting at this, and unfortunately this is all third hand because I didn't meet them when I was out there, but what I heard is that they're being very, very delicate about not playing up how tied in the two of them are together, but that, you know, the TV is the TV thing and the MMO is a complement to it, was what I heard. But I think this is a great idea. I want to see more crossovers like this.
Well, since I'm from the St. Louis area and I live in the San Francisco area, you got me.
Oh, yeah. Now, what's the story behind the TV show? This is, I know it's set in post-apocalyptic, but is this kind of just a total fiction story? It's a narrative or some kind of reality segment or something?
I don't have any more details than just what I've told you so far, which is they're both set in the same world and it's post-apocalyptic. And some things will happen in both. From this article, from a global standpoint, this could be a large political change, a big environmental change, and they'll happen simultaneously on both.
Okay, so is this what in your fantasy scenario is this the kind of thing where, like, you would love to play the MMO and then maybe have an offhanded comment from the characters in St. Louis refer to the such and such problem out west and be like, OMG, I was there. I fought that bad guy.
Well, yeah, I think some of the things you can do in an MMO involve everyone in the universe having to pitch in, right? In World of Warcraft, they're called world events. And everybody goes and has to do these quests in the world event, and it has a big effect on the world. And I could see something like that happening within this storyline that is then carried through in St. Louis. And they're like, yeah, did you hear about the uprising in San Francisco? You know, it was or wasn't successful based on how the game goes. That'd be kind of cool.
So this also seems like an opportunity to make a lot of hay with some of the secondary characters. Back in the mid-90s, I played the Star Wars customizable card game, basically Magic the Gathering with Star Wars cards.
Yeah.
And because all the rare cards were the most important characters in the game, the ones that you saw a million of were the nobodies in the cantina. But as a result of playing the game a lot, you're like, oh, Momane Don, Hammerhead, he's a vegetarian. You just learn all this weird stuff. So I wonder if there will be this kind of collection of secondary characters in the big show that are a big deal in the MMO.
Yeah,
and vice versa.
It's quite possible. But it's a cool idea for integrating that I haven't seen anybody pull off yet, so I hope they do. Let's take a quick break and thank our sponsor, Netflix. You can watch streaming television shows in all different kinds of ways. Movies, TV shows on your Mac, your PC, your iPad, on your iPhone, on your Android phone, on your Xbox, your PS3, your Nintendo Wii. Put them right up there on your TV. If you're not a gamer, Apple TV works, Roku box works. So many ways to get Netflix on your television. And then you can watch great TV shows and movies. But movies like Harry Brown or Pulp Fiction, I Saw the Devil, Silence of the Lambs, Clerks, Reservoir Dogs, all of these are streaming right now on Netflix. Even the Star Trek reboot, you just sit down and press play and watch them.
What I love so much about the Netflix streaming are the movies that you never would have discovered if it weren't for Netflix Instant Streaming. For example, I saw just now as you scrolled down, I saw Beer Wars in there, which is an amazing tale of the mass monopolization of beer distribution. And then meanwhile, Ponyo up there at the top, I was just scrolling past it, and my kid was just like, what's that one? What's that one? And so I hit play, and they love it. It's their all-time favorite kids movie now. And I never would have discovered it if it weren't for Netflix Instant Streaming. Even getting the DVD, I'd be like, oh, it's so precious. I can only pick one DVD to have come to me, and I wouldn't have picked that one. I would have gone with a safe choice. But because you have nothing to lose but a few minutes of your time, that's what's great about Netflix Instant Streaming.
So here's what you do. If you're already a Netflix customer, you know all this stuff. But if you're not, or if you know of someone who isn't yet, you give them 30 days free, or you take 30 days free on Netflix to try it out. Say, I don't have to believe Brian Brushwood and Tom Merritt. You know,
please don't.
They're crazy people. One of them's got weird hair, and the other's got weird hair in his face. I'm not going to believe either one of them. I'm going to go to netflix.com/twit and get 30 days free of Netflix and decide for myself. Be sure to use that URL, though, when you sign up, because that helps support Framerate and all the shows at Twit. We thank Netflix for their support of Twit. We hope you enjoy watching instantly with Netflix. Kind of think you will. So tell a friend. Give it a try. We appreciate their support. Shall we move then on to our... which one do we do next? Tube Tops or Film Found?
Film Found.
Film Found. All right.
Film Found.
I love that typeface.
You're pandering to the audience at this point. You are the lone person trashing the font. I'll say it's a font. That's what normal people call it. And now you're rolling underneath.
Wait, the size of the typeface is a matter of opinion?
The size of the typeface?
Yeah, you said font.
Okay. All right.
In one of the best measures against piracy to make content more easily available, Warner Brothers is streaming videos in China. Warner Brothers is the first to ink an official video-on-demand deal called You On Demand, the country's first pay TV service.
Yes, and this is definitely a step in the right direction. We've said this on the show before, not that we're universal experts on this kind of thing, But facing reality, if what you want to do is reduce piracy, then what you do is you have to create a viable alternative. And it sounds like the most interesting part of this whole article is that the videos on demand will be roughly what you would spend to buy a pirated copy of it. And now, of course, you don't get to hold on to it. You don't get to sell it afterwards. You don't get to keep it or give it to a friend. But if what you want is to watch something online, because I think what you discover, much as when, like from an environmental perspective, once different civilizations reach a certain level of affluency, they tend to take care of their own environmental needs. Likewise, I don't think that everybody wants to screw over the content makers. I think it's just a reality for the pay levels that a lot of people have and the market that's there with the piracy. Hopefully what this will do is give people an opportunity to actually pay something, even if it's not as much as we would expect here in the West.
So good job, Warner Brothers, on taking it to the video on demand service in China.
Now one thing on this, one thing in the story that I thought was really interesting was they get a protected monopoly here for a while. Is that correct?
Is that right?
I'm going to look for, the word monopoly doesn't show up on there, but it did mention in there that that they get for some of they'll be the only provider. Oh, and I guess the big trouble now is that they're trying to get distribution for everything. I'm trying to find it in here, but certainly, I guess
I was under the impression that they were just the only one who got a deal done, that it wasn't a protected thing. Because there are other VOD plays underway in the country.
It helps that YOD is entering China under a 20-year exclusive contract from the government to run national VOD services.
Right. So Warner Brothers isn't got a monopoly, but YOD. However, there are other video on demand services already in the country. Dox TV works with NDS to roll out the party to push VOD services in specific regions. So I guess YOD is the first nationwide one.
All right, so here's the question then. Is this just the first brick to fall? Is all of a sudden everybody's going to get in and be like, well, at least let's get something out of China?
Well, I think if you say everyone by meaning movie studios, yes.
Yes.
I think everyone's going to watch Warner Brothers a little bit, kind of keep like, how's that deal doing for you? But then, pretty quickly everybody else will follow. It would be my guess. I don't really know the landscape of China well enough to say for sure, though.
Yeah.
Let's look then now at the most important part of film now.
Yeah!
The summer movie draft recap.
Oh.
This is a huge week.
A new leader.
Bow before your leader. Bow before Justin Robert Young, the
Kneel
number
before
one
Young.
Player.
Yes, so Justin Robert Young. Now, is this correct? He has had all of his movies play now.
Yeah.
Yes, he is out.
He ends on top, $406 million, but he can never make, he can make another dollar because some of the movies are still in theaters, but he can never make a big splash. He doesn't have another big release coming. Sarah Lane, $401 million, still has Harry Potter yet to come.
Everybody knows that Harry Potter won't make a single dime that the changeup will actually cost the studio's money. They'll have a negative. They'll actually pay people to come see the movie. So I think it's pretty clear who the big winner is going to be.
Deathly Hallows is going to be in 3D. So not only is it the last Harry Potter movie, but they're putting it out in 3D. It's getting good press for its 3D. A lot of people are saying, hey, this looks like it might be worth it in 3D. So it's not only going to be making huge amounts of money because people want to see the last Harry Potter movie, but it will also make extra money because it's going to have 3D showings.
I didn't even think about that when I was looking at the analysis beforehand, because I went and I looked at the comps. Almost every single Harry Potter movie.
I don't think
they
had announced it was going to be in 3D back then. I don't remember whether they had or not.
Oh, maybe so. Yeah, that could be, because when I looked at the comps, like almost every single Harry Potter movie made $300 million plus or minus $10 million like clockwork.
Yeah.
And but if I had thought about the 3D thing in advance, not only is it, you figure it's going to bump because it's the last one, you figure, but a much bigger bump. I'm going to say this might be a $400 million movie now to look at it.
Everybody is now in the pool after this last weekend. Cargill was our last player without a movie that had played. Green Lantern premiered Father's Day weekend, and man, was I wrong. I thought it was going to do well because Father's Day weekend and all the hype, $58 million. I mean, it's not horrible,
but at least it was, if not a commercial success, at least it was pure comic book gold. At least they really pleased all the fans of the show with the hard hitting,
Brian,
awesome.
I think people are kind of pissed about this. It was getting really bad reviews. And
Oh. Folks didn't really like it much.
I didn't work out so hot then.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, though. Cargill, that means that in order to stay in the game or have even a chance at the top, Transformers Dark of the Moon has to be a $400 million movie. And this is something I was debating.
And I think it will be, honestly. But, yeah.
I don't know. Here's the thing is, I suspect there will be a bit of a lag from how bad Transformers 2 was. Now, Transformers 2 was a big commercial success, but it was so bad that even though, by all reports, Transformers 3 is supposed to be very good, I wonder if people are going to be a little bit burnt off from the last movie, and that'll affect sales going forward this
time.
But
it is July 4th weekend.
Oh, that's right. No, that'll be a big.
And I think that is a bigger surety than Father's Day weekend was for Green Lantern.
Yeah. Now, here's the big question to me. I think it's obvious at this point that Sarah's going to win. I got to be honest, it's going to be you and me fighting for second place.
I don't know. Cargill's got Transformers. I think he'll be right in there.
I don't know. He's only got $58 million.
Now, you don't have any movies left either, right? Oh, no, have Zookeeper.
I got two movies.
Oh, Captain America. Okay, yeah.
And Zookeeper. And Zookeeper is going to be one of those movies where it's like, whether or not you like it, it's a comedy starring Kevin James. Last time, The Grown-Ups last year was over $100 million. It was going to be, one of those Night at the Museum type things. Paul Blart, all those. They all, they got bankable names, and they're solid comedies that our grandfathers enjoy.
Now, don't forget, we have right there in the middle of the pack, Jason Howell, our very own producer of Frame Rate, $221 million, and he's got Cars 2 this weekend.
Yeah.
I expect huge things for Cars 2, because I heard you guys talking about it earlier. Cars 1, obviously not their biggest financial success at the theater, but Cars is the biggest merchandising franchise of all of Disney history, which means that there are kids who have spent their entire lives, all 5 years of it or whatever, watching and being programmed by Cars. And when they hear that it's Cars 2, every boy, every kid is going to be like, Cars 2, Cars 2. I think there's a really good chance that this could be a blockbuster. Unprecedented Pixar success.
Not to mention Pixar has yet to really, it almost seems like they roll out a movie every summer almost, and you're always anticipating the next one because there really hasn't been a super failure Pixar movie yet. So
never.
I'm sure the kids see that a new Pixar movie is coming out, whether they know Cars or not, they're going to want to go see it. It's just always a good time.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right. I have not watched any movies since our last recording, at least not in the theaters.
I did.
What have you got?
Well, I went to the Alamo Drafthouse to watch Super 8, and it was sort of on a whim. It was because, actually, I just done the Weird Things podcast with Andrew Main, and that was his pick. I was like, well, let's go, Bon. So we went to the Alamo Drafthouse, and as you know from last week's episode, they've got their big no texting in the theater thing that they're doing. And so I tweet out, this is right before the movie, I tweet out, hey, at the Alamo Draft House watching Super 8. And then all of a sudden, way loud, my phone goes, choo-choo! And I'm like, oh, crap! And I pick it up, and I kid you not, it's an at reply from Larry Fong, the cinematographer of Super 8, who we had on NSFW a few weeks back, saying, don't forget to turn off your phone or they'll kick you out.
So and he almost gets you kicked out doing it.
Yes, exactly. And I'm watching his movie. It was this most awesome confluence of weirdness in there. But I really liked Super 8. And I can understand people were saying like it was missing a something and they don't know what. And I don't know what it is either, but I can see why they would say, oh, well, this isn't the next E.T. or whatever. But man, was it pretty, and did it touch all the right parts of nostalgia in my body? I mean, it was fantastic. I really enjoyed it a lot. And I heard some complaints about the creature design. I like the creature design. Spoiler alert, mild hot sauce.
What are you thinking? Like the yellow, maybe?
Yellow. Yellow.
Spoiler alert, yellow. The only thing that I didn't care for was that the face was a little too anthropomorphized. I would have preferred something a little more alien. But again, when you're making a whole movie about, touching people's hearts, you got to make something relatable about the creature.
Stop touching my heart.
The nostalgia in my body is mine. You keep your hands off of it, J.J. Abrams.
You nostalgia raper. All right. Let's move on quickly to Tube Tops. American Gods, the book, is going to be turned into miniseries, and in fact, they've committed to 6 seasons of it on HBO, which means that Neil Gaiman has to write another book to give them enough material.
They actually committed?
Yeah.
What? This is unprecedented, is it? I mean, can you think of another series?
I don't know if it's unprecedented for HBO.
If this were like, you know, broadcast or cable, you know, regular non-premium, then yes, I think it would be totally unprecedented. HBO may have done this before. I just don't know.
Well, I'm certain they, and actually just made news that Game of Thrones got renewed after it launched, right?
Yeah.
So that means they didn't do that for Game of Thrones. They didn't commit to six seasons.
Yeah, this is pretty crazy. Neil Gaiman's going to be writing on the show as well. IO9 has a poll up who should be cast as the leads in American Gods. Now, I don't know all of these folks.
The characters or the actors?
The actors. But I know enough of them that this is pretty fun to page through.
Yeah, and actually, I didn't know if we were going to go through it ourselves, but I'm like you. There are too many of these names that I didn't recognize on site. But the ones that I did, I enjoyed seeing in there. And to be honest, you know, any of them are going to be fantastic at it. I really enjoyed American Gods as the book. I listened to it on Audible. It was read by George Guidall. I highly recommend it. I got to tell you, though, I liked American Gods a lot, and I really liked Anansi Boys, the not the sequel, but kind of the side novel to it. I don't see how it's going to be as epic or six seasonsable as Game of Thrones.
Like, well, no, it's and that's why Neil Gaiman is writing another book, because I think they realize, well, we can't get a full six out of this. So let's have some more material. Let's have another story to dig into. That's pretty weird to me.
But even the whole let's take just American Gods. Do you think they could even get three seasons out of that one book?
Yeah, I do. I think they could. 3 12 episode seasons. I think you could. I mean, the fact that they squeezed Game of Thrones into 12 felt too rapid. There was
No. I'll tell you where Game of Thrones, and of course we're going to talk about Game of Thrones since the season just ended. But it was very dense with Game of Thrones. But what they masterfully did was they would condense so many feelings into that would take pages of backstory.
I know they did a good job with that stuff. But I still think you could have done a 24 episode season of Game of Thrones, and it would have been just as good.
Yeah. I guess so.
I'm not. Don't take this as a criticism that they did a bad job. I'm just saying.
We hear you. You hated this performance of Game of Thrones.
That I despise HBO's Game of Thrones. No. That's not what I'm saying. That's not what I'm saying at all.
You don't even fight it. I like that about you, Merritt.
All right. Also, Japanese Nintendo 3DS is going to get 3D TV service with the help of Fuji TV, Nintendo's Itsu No Mani Terebi, or Spot Pass TV, which is easier for me to say, will bring a number of short-format 3D TV programs to the handheld, including shows featuring sumo wrestling, cute animals, daily tips on performing magic tricks. So it's not broadcast 3D, but it's getting little 3D TV shows. Maybe this is a better use of 3D for entertainment than television.
I'm going to make a prediction that this will be the single most wildly successful implementation of 3D TV of all, because
which means it'll be wildly used.
No. I mean, I'm going to say in the relative scheme of things, it'll be nothing compared to 3D use in the box office. But you have a malleable audience, in that they're mainly youngsters. You have glasses free, and you have a ubiquitous, automatically 3D implemented item. I'm going to say this is as sweet as it gets for 3D, and I'm going to say that a year from now, 2 years from now, people are going to be like, 3D is dead, except for on the 3DS, where it's incredibly popular.
Yeah. I don't think anybody will ever say it's dead, but I think they may say, this is the only place where 3D entertainment is actually doing any kind of good stuff. It's been doing gangbusters in movie theaters. You have to admit that.
Yes.
Maybe people are starting to catch on and not wanting to do it anymore, but.
Right. Well, I think people are figuring out what kind of movies people respond to in 3D and which ones they don't. I mean, it wasn't like Gulliver's Travels in 3D. Like, what was that about?
Yeah, almost everything has been in 3D. I mean, driving Miss Daisy, and I don't really need
that's 3D. Right. The steering wheel, his sorrow, it's in 3D. I can feel like I can reach out and wipe away.
A tear fell out of the screen on my eye. All right, TV shows. Lots of summer launches happening. In fact, July 11th is the big day for sci-fi. That's when Alpha premieres. That's when Eureka is supposed to come back. Haven is going to be launching later that week. So all the sci-fi stuff gets replaced. Sanctuary just had its mid-season finale. So it's off now after a cliffhanger. Which I thought the third season of Sanctuary was just fine. I like Sanctuary, and it was just fine. It's not something I think everybody has to watch. Outcasts premiered on BBC America, an original for BBC America, set where the people are fleeing a destroyed Earth, and very few folks have made it to a planet called Carpathia. Lots of little intrigue and stuff. I was impressed. I just watched it on a whim. I wasn't that excited about it, and I think that is one to keep an eye on. Instead of watching Falling Skies, I watched Outcast. Falling Skies is the Spielberg TNT show that is also post-apocalyptic Earth.
So did you ever watch Falling Skies or you did not?
I did not. I watched Outcast instead. I turned on Outcast thinking, I'm going to watch Falling Skies, but let me just watch a few minutes of this to get the flavor of it. And I got sucked in and watched the entire episode. And then I was like, I don't have time to watch Falling Skies now. I'm going to bed.
Okay, so both are sci-fi. Falling Skies is what? We're occupied. And Outcast is we run away to a different planet.
Yeah, and Falling Skies is not getting great reviews either.
You know what? Patrick Delahanty is very into this kind of thing. And just before he asked if I saw it, I've been on the road, and he was just like, he's not optimistic about it.
So I'm telling you, if you're looking for a post-apocalyptic feel, go to Outcasts on BBC America. It replaced Doctor Who on Saturdays. Now that Doctor Who is in its mid-season break as well.
Thankfully, we know there was nothing else really worth watching this entire week, right? I mean, there's nothing.
Wait, what are you talking about?
Wait, I mean, was there any other shows besides Falling Skies, Outcast? Sanctuary?
So You Think You Can Dance is now like really close to the finals. We're starting to get.
That'd be good. In fact, I'll bet the final So You Think You Can Dance would be a really big deal.
Yeah, no, I mean, other than that, I can't think of anything else.
America's All right, well, Best let's Dance a sponsor, Girl maybe, or.
Or should we go to the sponsor? Yeah, let's go to the sponsor. Yeah.
We should go to spoiler alert freaking red and talk about Game of Thrones. Because.
Spoiler alert.
We need to have red flashing lights in the new studio for that.
Awesome. You'd hook him up to a USB switch. He presses one button and everything just goes red all at once.
If you have not read the book Game of Thrones, stop your podcast right now.
And if you
have not read the book, and you haven't seen the final episode of Game of Thrones, stop your podcast right now. You should only watch this if you've watched all the episodes of Game of Thrones on HBO, or if you've read the book and you feel like I'm not really going to be that spoiled about knowing how they did it on the TV show. Otherwise, stop.
Yeah, we've said that before. It's not really a spoiler if you've already know the story, if you've read the book. But the implementation, look, from beginning to end, without doubt, HBO absolutely bat 1,000 on this series. Like, when my only gripe is, well, I thought that plot point came out in the future book. I mean, it was nailed, the emotions of it. I cannot believe they condensed so big, so sweeping a story in there with such surprises. They just nailed it. Just nailed it.
From beginning to end, it has been pitch perfect. In fact, some of my earlier concerns, like, I didn't really like the way they were portraying Catherine. In the first few episodes, and now that that character has come into her own. And maybe it was just because I knew this is what she was supposed to be like, and she isn't really like that yet in the early parts, but I thought she was portrayed kind of weakly at first. Not anymore. Now we've got her saying, first we get our daughters back, then we kill them all. As soon as she said that line, I was like, that's Cat. That's my Lady Catherine right there.
You know what? I just realized that I'm afraid we need a spoiler alert even higher than red, because what I'd like to do is talk about what's going to happen in future books. But I don't even want to do that. I just want to keep it to what we've seen.
Well,
but
we did see a peek into a future book with Joffrey on the landing with Sansa. And then the first time we see Sansa actually resisting him. That is actually in the next book. It's not in Game of Thrones.
Okay, good. So you knew that. And then I'll tell you what I really liked was the way they handled that with her having a dark thought. And then just as she moved, having the Hound lean in to clean her face as if, he knew.
That's not from the book. That's a different character. But I like, this is one of those good choices that you're talking about. They said, you know what? We need to establish her relationship with the Hound. We don't have time to go through all the tricks that they do in the book. So let's have him do that, because that in that one piece establishes, aha, he cares for her.
Yes, and not in any big way, but in a, look, I have loyalty and I have a job, but I have, you know, no desire to see you hurt beyond that. But again, the entire first book, I thought they did a much bigger job of, first of all, they paint him as more hideous as the Hound, and also as an ugly person as well. So you spend the entire first book fearing the Hound and seeing no redeeming qualities about him. But then, you know, in the story, they make him a little bit more sensitive, and they make him more sympathetic in that they tell the story about him and Gregor Clegane.
Yeah, the mountain.
Yeah. But of course, the big money shot of the whole thing was the way they handled the end. The one part of the whole book, you spend the whole, it's so weird because you spend the whole time that you go into this being told it's a fantasy story and seeing no fantasies, no fantasy anything. Maybe a mysterious alive hand or zombie nod or something like that.
Blue but eyes, dead coming back to life. It's pretty fantastical.
Yeah, but I mean, we see that on The Walking Dead. That ain't fantasy. But and so then this end scene,
no, that's a
when you get MFing dragons, DRRAGONS.
Now, some people complained that in the book, you actually get to stay with her through the entire night, and it's much more dramatic, and that this sort of fading to black, and then you just open up, and there she are with a few dragons. I totally disagree with those people. I think you had to do it this way. It would have been boring if you stayed with her all through the night. Sure, they might have been able to make an acknowledgement of it with a quick look, but the drama, for anybody who didn't read the book, of seeing her walk into the fire and then cutting to the next morning and seeing the smoking remains, having her stand up with the dragons, her clothes have burnt off, right? Her hair was actually supposed to be burnt off, too. They didn't go that far.
Okay. See, I was wondering that because Bonnie said she remembered that. And by the way, it's hilarious to me how much of the book I've forgotten. I mean, this whole thing has been like the Cliff Notes version of this awesome book I read 5 years ago. So that was in there, that her hair burnt off, and then she sort of was born anew, right?
Yeah, exactly. This is supposed to be her rising from the ashes, literally and figuratively both. And we get to see the mother effing dragons for the first time.
Well, and here's the other thing, too. In that scene, when she stands up and everybody is absolutely stunned and they just bow in sheer awe of her as a person, how different is that character? That's when you realize this entire time you thought you were watching a show about Sean Bean. You're watching the show about the transformation of a young, abused little sister into something completely fundamentally
this
different.
Show is this entire series, and we're in spoiler alert level red, but I'm even going to go redder. This entire
reddest.
Series is, in my opinion, this is just my opinion, is about Daenerys and Jon Snow.
Yes, it is. And much like the first book, you spend a lot of time, you know, enjoying these other characters, and you discover that it's not really their story, it's someone else's story, and it just gets bigger and bigger. So awesome. The one thing I missed that, and I don't see any way they could have stuck it in, I really liked the way in the books they portrayed her future as it was going to be without the call, with the call dead, like, oh, you go to be part of this group of old crones and nobodies on the side. And then, you know, faced with that. But again, I understand that television is a different medium. No complaints. I was really happy with the way they did everything. I guess that's it. And I think I agree with that JPEG everybody's sending around. Just give Tyrion Lannister the Emmy already, right?
Oh, Peter Dinklage, man. Yeah, he has exceeded my expectations. He doesn't look the way I imagine Tyrion, but I have forgotten all about that. He is Tyrion.
Like, and that's something huge. When an actor can be so good, he can fundamentally redefine not only the way you picture the character, but the way the author expressly wrote the character, and then still make you fall in love with him. That is really something, and I cannot say enough good things about what he did to redefine that character for me.
All right, let's take a quick break and thank our sponsor, Squarespace.com. If you think we need a spoiler alert level plaid, for instance, as Pete Delahanty does, you could start spoileralertplaid.squarespace.com right now and get it up and running and looking professional. I mean, that's not even a site that has to look professional, but it would if you use Squarespace. The fast and easy way to create a website or blog.
I noticed that it says here squarespace.com code framerate6. Because there were no codes for a while, because it was like you go to the website, you do your free two-week trial, but now you get a code. What does the code do?
Okay, so you still get the free trial, and you still don't need a credit card to sign up. So you can do it right now and have a website going lickety-split. However, if you decide to keep the service and pay for it, Use the offer code FRAMERATE6 and you get 30% off your first 3 months.
I'm sorry. Did you? It sounded like you said 30%.
I did say 30% off your first 3 months.
So that's like almost the same as you pay for 3 months, but you pretty much get four. I mean, you get like a secret free month off somewhere in there.
Practically speaking, yes.
Awesome.
FRAMERATE6 is the code. Go to squarespace.com, import your old blog, or start a new one right now. It's going to look awesome. Check out forecastpodcast.com if you want to see an example of how good a site can look. Or if you need to be making a site for somebody else, use Squarespace. It'll be easy for you, and then you can charge them a lot for your services. Just saying. All right. Squarespace.com, FRAMERATE 6. We thank them for their support of FRAMERATE. On now to Interferon.
Interferon. Shoot me up, Jeff Goldblum.
So we have an email for our Interferon submission today.
Yeah, this one comes from Nick Etherton, and he writes, "Hey, Framerate gang," and I should disclose that we haven't actually looked at these links. We thought it'd be fun to explore it together. "Hey, Framerate gang, Stickleless from the chat room here. Just wanted to point out to you guys the teaser trailers that have been coming out for the new Muppets movie. First, we had this attached to Pirates of the Caribbean, and we'll see that in a moment, followed by two more movie parody teasers. I won't spoil what the parodies are, just check them out, one and two. I think it's really interesting to see the Muppets make these types of references and use YouTube as a vital part of their marketing strategy for the movie. Personally, I'm loving these, and they feel right at home with the Muppets universe. Just wondering as to what your take was on this." And I do want to check them out, but first let me say, you know, the Muppets were always hip. I mean, even when they were not hip, they were still hip, especially like in the late 70s. They were all about, you know, adult references.
Well, the earliest Jim Henson work was these coffee commercials that were like totally edgy with like Muppets shooting each other for not drinking the right coffee and stuff.
And not that we're saying that the Muppets are edgy so much, but like they've always
been totally violent.
we're saying that Muppets are gangsters.
Muppets will kill you.
Let's take a look at the I don't know which one you have queued up, Jason.
I have all three. We could start with the first one, Pirates of the Caribbean.
Yeah, let's hit them up.
Hi.
Two people searching for love.
This is the most romantic thing ever. I've always dreamt of seeing Los Angeles.
One chance to go the distance.
I was just wondering what the plan was for dinner tonight.
Oh, I don't care. What do you feel like?
Okay. I'm going to go for a walk.
But sometimes...
I forgot my anniversary with Mary.
You have to break your heart.
You know when you've been trying to figure something out and you can't figure it out and you figure it out and you're like, duh.
To find its other half.
You're my best friend.
Jason Segel.
I love Mary. I love her so much and I can't lose her.
Amy Adams.
I love you too.
Kermit the Frog.
Hi there.
Miss Piggy.
Kermit!
Whoa. Wait, stop. Are there Muppets in this movie?
Oh, yeah.
Come on, guys, let's go!
The Muppets.
Wow, that was an expensive-looking explosion. I can't believe we had that in the budget.
So I had seen this one before. I didn't realize this is the one that came out with the Pirates of the Caribbean movie. But I got suckered in first time I saw it. I was like, this looks like a genuinely
Well, it's got Amy
movie.
Adams in it. So you're like, oh, of course. You know, Amy Adams going to do a romantic comedy?
Yeah. But then, like, you know, I usually get swept into trailers and I don't notice when they're poorly executed. But it's like, this sounded like one of those YouTube fan-made trailers. It was so generic and cheesy in its execution that I was just like, what is this terrible movie? That's such a terrible trailer. And then the Muppets showed up. And I was like, ah, you got me, you bastards. But I have not seen these other two.
Jammy bastards.
All right, want to play the second one?
Yeah.
Here we go. Why is it not playing?
This one is a different one.
Over the years, they've said...
The Xanadu of family entertainment. Absolutely hilarious, sometimes on purpose. I had no idea what they were talking about, Hollywood Reporter. What a bunch of lunatics this week monthly. It is. This one's definitely a visual joke for those of you on the audio podcast. The fuzzy pack is back. The Muppets.
So this is clearly riffing on The Hangover 2, right?
Yes. The Muppets.
Yes, that's right.
Hey, I'm a Muppet.
That one's not as good for me.
Oh, no way. This one's a million times better. This one was note perfect, dude. That one's way better. That one's new champion, as far as I'm concerned.
You don't go through it thinking, looking at a movie. You just see a few scenes. They had to, and the Muppets come really quickly.
I thought it was way better.
All right, let's see the last one, and we will judge for ourselves.
In brightest day, in darkest night, no evil shall escape my sight. Let those who laugh at my lack of height beware my banjo. Green Froggy's light.
Sorry about that, guys. Something in my throat.
We need you.
Come on, guys, let's go.
Muppets. It looks like the joke's about to be on them.
If I didn't know better, I'd say you were reciting some sort of an important plot point.
Wait, stop. Is this another Muppet trailer parody? Why don't we just show a real trailer? I mean, what are we hiding? Did we make the movie in Swedish or something?
Now, I like the fact that they acknowledge the sort of like parody trailer premise
right.
in this one and take it over the top to like mock the most played trailer in all of history, the Green Lantern trailer.
Yes. Well, and in fact, I thought the first half, I was like, oh, well, this is my least favorite of all of them because there's nothing particularly Green Lantern-y about the footage that we're seeing. But it won me over at the end with referencing not only the parodical nature of the trailers, but the trailers themselves. I thought that was good. But second one's still the best.
First one's still Hangover. The best. Sorry.
All right.
Yep. Took me in all the way. Saw it in the theater, too.
Well, you want to read some other letters? Maybe do a little bit of feedback?
Oh, feedback.
Now it's time for feedback with Brian and Tom on Frame Rate. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Well, we started a war in the chat room. Chat room is all kinds of shouting up and down about whether it's the first, second, or third. A lot of people like the third one best.
Yeah, it seems like three is winning the chat room, yeah.
Yeah, I think so. I tell you what, I got an email here from Paul Meyer. Dear Brian and Tom, I heard you mention the TV show Supernatural a time or two, and I know you are aware of it. Was wondering if either of you have ever tried to watch it. I find it to be an excellent show with very dynamic plot points and fascinating characters. Similar to X-Files, it finds genius ways of mixing humor in with the horror and suspense. Supernatural will be starting its seventh season this fall. Hopefully one or both of you can find some time to give it a try and maybe enjoy it as much as I have. Thanks for the great show, Paul Meyer. Now, I actually have not watched a single episode of Supernatural, but I had 8 million people tell me to watch the episode called, I think the title of the episode was Chris Angel's a Douchebag or something like that.
Oh, right. Because the magic scene. That makes sense.
Yeah, exactly. But have you watched Supernatural at all?
I remember when Supernatural came on because one of the characters in it was on Smallville. And then the next season, he moved to Supernatural and he left Smallville. And the only other thing I know about Supernatural is at the end of every Smallville for several seasons, they would say, hey, this is Chris coming up next in all new Supernatural. Don't miss it.
Well, okay, so the reason I picked this one is because him challenging us to watch Supernatural reminded me of our Pinky Promise extravaganza for me watching Fringe and you watching Breaking Bad. Now, I have been on the road, so I have not started. But if you started, I want to see if we could work out an actual deadline.
No, we need to coordinate this much like our 10,000th tweet.
Yes, we did. We tweeted simultaneously. It was a beautiful moment between the two of us. I felt at one with Tom Merritt.
Yeah, that was, you know, go back on your Twitter logs if you want to relive that moment. But I'm not going to start till you start and then we'll kind of time it that way.
I tell you what, I'll let you know when, and I'm going to tell you, man, it's going to be like The Wire. Once you get started, you're going to leave me in the dust.
Well, we're getting very close to the time when I watched The Wire last year. So that would be good.
Awesome.
Okay. Well, then I'm going to read the next email. Fine. Enough agreeing. Matt in Vienna, Virginia says, I'm not sure I share your enthusiasm for Starz movies on Netflix, While I agree that some of the best films on Netflix in terms of quality content are usually from Stars, I have serious problems with the quality of the stream that Netflix gets from them. Every time I start a movie and see the Stars intro, my heart sinks because I know I'm going to get a pretty bad-looking film. The bitrate seems lower. I haven't seen an HD stream from them, though I haven't looked hard. And worst of all, the video is usually altered to fit to 16:9. It's like the days of pan and scan, Alice in Wonderland, for example. I adore Netflix, but they need to work on the technical quality of their content. I'm still waiting for surround sound from them. So he starts to kind of veer off into other issues. Sounds like a video file, which I am not, but I've heard this before that people say, wow, stuff on Netflix looks great, except when it comes from Stars, it seems like they're getting a lower quality bitrate.
Yeah, you know what? I'd hate to. I am the last person to complain. You know, I'm always saying convenience over fidelity, but I do notice, especially just the Stars intro itself, it looks like it was taken off of a VHS tape and may have actually been, and that may be the nature of what they're able to get with their agreement with Netflix. I don't know. Have you noticed it at all?
I just real quick, I think what happens, it's the same thing that happens with Skype sometimes, is that in the beginning it's buffering just to get started, and then it kind of irons itself out. Because I've noticed that on the Stars intro as well. It's almost always fuzzy, and I think that the video is going to follow that, and maybe it does immediately, but then eventually it kind of clears up a little bit more. So I think maybe it's just buffering it out. But I don't know that for sure.
Yeah, and I do. Usually about 20 minutes in, all of a sudden it'll pause and say, hey, your signal quality has changed. And then all of a sudden it looks like it's in HD.
Yeah, it would be nicer if it started that way instead of 20 minutes in, though.
But then again, I mean, we say that, like, there's what consumers think they want. Like, what we think we want is for it to always be HD. But it may be that they tested and say, you know what? People get ticked off if the movie for our instant streaming takes 30 seconds to buffer.
Oh, they absolutely do. So, you know, everybody's going to complain about something.
Yeah.
I want it to start immediately and be perfect from the beginning.
Yeah, I don't think that's too much to ask. All I want is to watch anything I want in the topmost quality, instantaneous, at a reasonable fee. And by reasonable, I mean pretty much free.
Yeah.
I don't think that's.
And I want to be in the movies I watch.
Oh, yes, absolutely. In fact, I would love it if they had some software that would write algorithms to where in various movies, whether it's a romantic comedy or an action movie, they mention my name throughout the thing. You're like, this will affect Brian Brushwood's ability to watch movies.
You know, True Blood did that as a promotion, because True Blood's going to restart here very soon.
No way.
And
what did they do?
They did a viral video where you would put in your Facebook account, and it would take your name and the name of several of your Facebook friends. Was it Facebook or Twitter? If Eileen's still here, she'll tell me. But then they would work it into printed stuff. Not the characters wouldn't actually speak your name, but they would be saying, like, oh, hold on, I just got an email. And it would be from, you know, your sister or something.
That's awesome. They would look at your relationships. So it did that thing where, like, it maps the text onto a screen or something like that? That's awesome.
Yep.
Are you still watching True Blood? I know that's...
Yeah,
that's
I love really True what... Blood. It's great. It's been new season is starting shortly.
Well, I know this because boy has HBO promoted the ever loving hell out of it. In fact, my DVR started recording Game of Thrones right on the dot, and I got like 6 minutes of previews. Like they knew the whole world was watching the end of Game of Thrones.
And they know people are excited about True Blood. I mean, I started the Game of Thrones. Eileen was just coming in from the kitchen, and she was like, "Rewind that. I have to see the preview." So
that's awesome.
All right, that's it for this edition of framerate show@gmail.com is our email address. Please do send us email. We love getting them. We read every single one of them, and we hold them close to our hearts like a teddy bear every night.